Okay, let's speak about which is the best suggestion that you can give to a single person, a family, or a council.
Very good question. First of all, for the parents, it's a real good idea to spend time on themselves and with the kids to improve the vision in the weekend, when they're out of work and they can do exercises. But to spend 10 minutes a day working on themselves and 2 minutes here and 2 minutes there in the middle of work. Like, for example, people here have to be productive. You're not going to just let them leave their post and do eye exercise. But if they go out for 2 minutes and wave their hands to the side and look at the distance and rest their eyes and then sit back at the computer, they'll be more productive for you. And that would be true even for much bigger companies. And actually, between you and me, if we ever succeeded to get to the big companies, doesn't matter where, in America, in France, in Italy, doesn't matter where, and teach workers to not tense their eyes and to not tense their body, it would be much better for them. So I can see people looking at a distance. I can see people sometimes palming for like when they start the lunch break to relax their eyes and palm and rest their eyes. I can see people working, not all the 4 pieces of paper we have yesterday were two because the lecture is short, it was only 2 hours,
Yes.
yeah? But having a small piece of paper and waving their hands to the side to stop them from tensing looking at the computer, anything that takes away visual stress is great. Now, with kids, it's different. You start to teach kids eye exercises from a young age, so less kids will have myopia, so they don't have the condition that they will need to deal with in the future. Because myopia is not something that ends. You start with myopia, the eye becomes longer and longer and longer, and one day the retina detaches. And it could take 40, 50 years. But why start the process? You start when you're young to improve your vision, and that's quite a good possibility. So what I think that it's a good family time to do things. For example, when we did palming, my 2 kids were born with cataracts. So my ex-wife and I, we would sit down with the kids and palm, and each one of us will tell a story. And we were thinking about black to relax the eyes, a black prince, a black horse, running in the forest. And I would start a story, then my son would continue the story, then my daughter would continue the story, then my wife would continue the story, and then I would continue. And so the whole family had a story to tell, and it was a wonderful family time until now. My son is almost 26, my daughter is almost 23. When they meet, they take punch glasses and they play ball with each other, and then their eyes feel better because my daughter studies a lot and my son works a lot, so the eyes are better. And in spite of the fact they were born with cataracts, the vision is so good, And so it should be a part of family life to work on the eyes, and it makes the family closer.
Can I stop you some?
Anytime.
Just do you like to say something? What is your experience traveling the world, seeing all these people that speak?
I love that. I really appreciate to be in contact with different culture, and what I love most is to see hope in the eyes of people when they discover they can improve and can help themselves. That is my gift. All my life was about vision. My mother was blind, my husband was blind, and 2 uncles too. And I had a severe problem too. So he helped me to not have the surgery. And just in 1 month, the same surgeon stopped to recommend it. He said I didn't need that. So I think strongly that I have to bring his method in my country, in Quebec City, in Canada. And it's like a continuity in my life. So it's a wonderful journey.
And so you have seen other people that improved their vision?
Constantly, yes.
Constantly.
Yes. And for vision and for different other diseases too, or paralysis, so.
Very good.
Fascinating and exciting in the same time.
E tu, Isabella, che cosa stai apprezzando di questa stare insieme?
Everything Mayer says is really very, is fascinating and very, very inspiring. And I think it's very important to spread this information. There are some very little suggestions that people can bring in their everyday life. And there are very important information, like, for instance, not to use sunglasses. So it's very important to spread this this kind of information. And I'm trying to think that that could be a relation between a connection between your the way you see and the way you feel, or your relationships. What I'm thinking, and I wonder, but maybe it's not true, does the way you see affect the way you feel and the way you relate in your relationships with other people?
Absolutely. I want to tell you something interesting. I think whenever people improve their vision, they also improve their intuition. It's like they almost can predict the phone call is going to be made. I mean, I wouldn't say it's always the case, and it's nothing scientific in particular, but it feels to me like, you know, we do have a third eye, so when we work on these two eyes, it wakes it up to a great extent. Returning to science, it just makes sense that whatever you do with your eyes will affect everywhere in your body. Because if you think about the fact that the retina receives 1 billion light rays every minute, 1 billion, okay? And the brain has to actually block most of it and only take patterns, then that is a huge thing. What I'm seeing in you is not you, but the reflection that comes from you. It's actually what you block is what I'm seeing. Because what I'm seeing is light, and it's being blocked in many different places. And then my brain interprets what I'm seeing to help me understand the world which is in front of me. By the way, it shows you to a great extent how much our world is to some extent an illusion in that sense, you know. But what I'm seeing is what's coming my way with my interpretation of what's coming my way.
And I want to ask you something. What can we do about children, not only about in family, but also in school, in society?
You know, in the beginning of last century, and towards the end of the century before that, the 1800s, they made big windows like this one in schools. They thought that kids need light. Because of a lot of reading, they lose vision. And then in 1962, there was one article. Normally, people don't change practice because of one research. One article, one research by some researchers in the ophthalmology magazine in England that said that nothing that you do for the eyes makes any difference. Which is completely counterintuitive to me or to anyone else. What do you mean you do nothing that makes any difference, right? So they just decided nothing to do makes any difference. They did twin studies. One twin was here, one twin was there, and there was no difference. Fine. From there on, they stopped having big windows. From there on, they closed the rooms. The windows were smaller. Kids are seeing worse. Okay? So, for example, what we can do for good kids is give them better visual conditions, more daylight, more windows, more breaks. When you go to the nurse to see if you don't see well, you don't just take glasses if you don't see well. You first do some eye exercises and see if within a month or two you'll see well again. And if you will, then forget glasses, because you start with glasses, There's no end to it, you know? So the idea is to revolutionize the whole thing from everywhere in the world. And in this case, it doesn't matter if it's Italy, and it doesn't matter if it's San Francisco. It makes no difference. If there's any place in the world that will start to work differently, it's like the 100 monkeys, then everywhere in the world will change as well. So you think Italy, and you think France, and you think Spain, I think the world.
Okay.
That's where we want to influence everywhere.
So, you told the myopia doesn't stop if you don't make exercises.
It stops, but you have to work very hard to make the exercise. But if you stop the myopia where it starts, you'll never have it.
And usually at what age it starts?
Normally it starts at the age of 9 or 10. To begin with, they teach children to read at the age of 6, and in some places the age of 5. They should not start to teach them to read before the age of 7. They should read to them, tell them stories, show them pictures, and only start to read from the age of 7. To continue with, these days, it's not good for macro, but it's also not good for people. People stop reading books. They just look at the internet for all kinds of solutions and resolutions. And I think it's terrible for people's psyche and for people's eyes. I personally think Kindles are good for business, but are bad for people. I think that the physical book that you open and you read, and you take some breaks, this is the thing that people didn't do. Look at the distance. And reading good light, outside light, is so much better than looking at Kindle and looking at computers. And these days, in universities, people stop reading books. They start to look for all the short ways, like answers in Google for everything, you know? There's something wrong with that. What's wrong with that is not going in depth into any subject. So you want to improve people's vision. First of all, teach them that a lot of information doesn't teach you anything. That actually going deeply into things teaches you much more. You can have less information, but be much more informed by having less information and go deeper. And these days, the whole thing is different. Much, much, much information and very little absorption. Let's put it this way.
And we have spoken about children.
Yeah.
What we can say about older people?
What we need to do with older people is encourage them to read print that they have easy time reading. Encourage them to, are you talking about old people, like 60, 70, 80, 90, right? Encourage them to read in the sun, but also encourage them to be physical. Do you know the story about this man was 47 and this French woman was 90? And there was a bet. He was about to pay her $500 a month. That was in the 60s. That was $500 was $500, right? So you were paying her $500 a month, and when she dies, he gets her apartment. He was 47, she was 90. Where can he lose? 30 years later, he dies at the age of 77 from a heart attack, and his family had to keep paying her for 4 more years. She died at the age of 124. What he didn't pay attention is that she was bicycling, she was fencing, mountain climbing. She was 90, okay. Well, I met a 90-year-old right now. Her name is Bridget in Quillan, near Toulouse, you know, when I went to France. And every time she eats lunch, she sits, she puts her legs up and sees the river flowing and eats, and she has a house, and she made a community out of her house, and she's trying to put people together and does many, many nice things. Well, so the point is, you want to live long, you have to have a purpose in life. You know, you don't have to do the work that you always did before, but you have to have a purpose in life, to feel you're doing something good. So you can volunteer and do something good for the public, you know. And this is, I heard that you're also a politician, so it's something that you could actually encourage older people in your town to do, to come and volunteer for the poor, volunteer for the hungry, volunteer for kids, everybody in their capacity, you know, teach kids chess, checkers, teach kids this and that, you know, give people a feeling that they open their eyes for a good reason. That's what old people can do, okay? But also in terms of their health, they need to walk, they need to stretch, they need to strengthen the body, and they need to work on their vision. Yeah, so that's a very important thing. They need to work on looking at a distance and working on the periphery, because here is their alternative: to sit for hours in the doctor's office waiting to see what the doctor thinks, and then getting this procedure and that procedure and that procedure, destroy the national safe, because there isn't enough money for all these procedures in the first place, you know, and in the meantime become more miserable all the time and more dependent. So the eye exercises is exactly what they need.
Okay.
And a sense of purpose. It's so important, because so many old people say, oh, I lived for my kids and I did this, and there's nothing now they can say about themselves. That's a mistake.
Can you tell me something about sunglasses?
Mm-hmm. Well, let's put it this way.
Because here in Italy, all the people, especially old men,
wear sunglasses. Who told them? The doctors told them to wear sunglasses, right?
No, sunglasses here in Italy are something to be macho, or maybe fashion,
more interesting,
all these things. But it is important that we say people that wear usually sunglasses also in winter time, also in evening time. What is the result?
Okay, let's put the results. First of all, your pupils don't constrict as easily. Let me give you an example. Look at her, for example, look at her face. Nice face, right?
Yes.
Now look through your fist. How does the face look to you? How does it look?
Little.
Okay. More little.
More clear, right?
Yes.
Because the pupils, when they constrict, here, look at his face,
mm-hmm,
and look like this. So you're... fist. Do you have pinholes? Do you know where they are?
No, but I know you need something.
You know the pinholes, right? Pinholes effect?
No, I can see him more clear.
More focused.
Yes.
It's called, fixation. So when the pupils constrict, there's more fixation. When you're in the daytime, the pupils are always smaller. In the nighttime, the pupils are always bigger. You put sunglasses and they interfere with the pupil constriction. So when they interfere with the pupil constriction, your fixation gets compromised. So your vision is not as clear. That's number one. Number two, we have a pigment in the retina and in the choroid, which is the blood that nourishes the retina, which is called melanin, that darkens the light anyway. It's behind the photoreceptors. The retina has 10 layers. So it's behind the photoreceptors and it darkens the light. Just like if you go to a photographer and he takes a picture, he has a lot of light, but he has paper behind you, so the light will not disperse. That's what the retina does. You wear sunglasses. You don't need the melanin as much. And that affects the production of the melanin for the eye and for the skin. So it makes actually a problem for the skin and for the eye, okay? The next thing which is very important is that the pupillary size affects your mood to a great extent. Because in emergency, the pupils are wide in the daytime. Like if you're afraid, they're wide, you know? So you don't even know why, but all of a sudden, a system which is called the sympathetic nervous system kicks in as if you're in an emergency without knowing that the reason is actually the pupils that are not shrinking as much as they should, okay? And that affects all your metabolism, that affects your liver, that affects your stomach, that affects your whole digestive system. The eye is very much connected to everything. Another thing is, the combination of light rays and blood is very important. When the light hits the retina, it meets the hemoglobin of the blood, and in some ways it creates a secretion of serotonin. And serotonin makes you optimistic, you know, as a neurotransmitter in the brain. So it's like the best antidepressant in the world to have the sun exposure. And it's the worst thing When you stop that, it leads to depression. And now the light also wakes up vitamin D production. You absorb it from the sun. It helps your bones, it helps your muscles, it helps your nerves, and it prevents cancer. So you have all the reason in the world to break your sunglasses. You know what I do with sunglasses? I break them and use one side and put black tape to patch one eye and do eye exercise with it. That's what I do with them, basically. Now, you can put sunglasses when there's a sunrise or sunset and you drive towards the sun. Mm-hmm. Yeah, those times, or if you want to look good in a party or something, but basically, sunglasses have to be in the pocket or broken.
Okay. Yesterday you told about 750,000 people
For every one person that has melanoma of the skin because of sun exposure, the medical profession keep hitting us. You get cancer, you get cancer. You don't get so much cancer from the sun. There's a case where the skin is really doing poorly and you get cancer. You get sometimes sores, and like I did, I irresponsibly sat down without a hat. You know, I'm all for hats in the sun, yes. But for one person that got melanoma of the skin because of sun exposure, you have 7,500 people who got osteoporosis because of lack of exposure to the sun. So they think, okay, drink milk and you get the vitamin D from the milk, or you take a supplement of vitamin D and it's the same thing, but it's not. The absorption is a very important process from the sun, and the digestion of it is not the same thing, and it doesn't get to the body in the same way.
Perfect. Which are the worst things that one person can do about its vision?
Read, look at a computer, not sleep well, not take rest, not go to nature, eat the wrong food all the time, not exercise in any way, not breathe deeply, intellectually focus on things. And that so many people do that. They would sit at a computer from 11 in the morning until 3 at night, you know, and be very, very interested in what they're seeing. So they will keep looking at the computer and keep looking at whatever they're seeing at that computer, and absolutely will not take rest. And that means that, you know, the body can do it. You know, you can get tired and then get tired and then you recover. And then tired and tired, you recover. Do it for 5 years and you will not recover. And then you think it's a symptom. So you separate the symptom. Oh, I have high pressure in my eye. Let's take drops. I have cataract. Let's remove it. I have this. Let's fix it. Everything is if it doesn't connect to what you do, but what you do is what causes it.
So it's not so worst to use glasses or lenses.
Contact glasses are very bad for you. Contacts are very bad for you, and LASIK is worse. Glasses are bad because when you wear glasses, it's like suggestive to not pay attention to your periphery. Also, if I want to see her, I move my head. I don't kind of sense her. I don't kind of sense her. I kind of move my head because my glasses freeze my gaze. Now, contacts don't have that problem because they move with the eyes. But the eyes should reject any foreign object. And if you don't reject it, then you can have a compromise of your immune system of the eye. So any little particle can cause red eye and all kinds of problems. Like, you know, somebody who doesn't have contacts, you have a particle, you blink, it goes away. But you have contacts, the immune system is so bad, it just doesn't reject things as easily.
But for your knowledge, which are the more usual effects of lens?
Of lenses, they don't allow your eyes to breathe. You know, they don't give you oxygen. So You know, if you're myopic, you see better with contact lenses than when you see with glasses. If you're presbyopic, you see better with glasses than with contacts, okay? But basically, glasses are not good for you, contacts are not good for you. LASIK is the worst. Is really the worst thing you could possibly think about, because they make glasses out of your cornea, so you have less cornea, which, by the way, violates the relationship. I mean, it's so such a harmony when the light falls in the cornea and then goes through the fluid, you know, the aqueous fluid in the eye, and then goes through the lens, and then goes through the vitreous, and the vitreous changes. It's like a vitreous is like a gel, you know, it changes a little bit for the light, and then the retina changes. And now you shave the cornea, and there is no good relationship anymore between the cornea and the rest of the eye. And people start to be light sensitive. So they see much better. And it's better than contacts and lenses in that you don't have to change them for 7, 9, sometimes 10 years. You don't have to change the prescription in a way. But after a while, the prescription doesn't work, so you have to put glasses or you shave them again, you know? And you can bump your head, and the cornea is a part of your protective area. You can get retinal detachment. So there's all kinds of problems from LASIK. So I'm not anti-glasses, you know? Sometimes, you know, look my kids, you know? They were born with cataracts, so their lens was removed, and they do wear thick glasses to see things. But I taught them to put them in the pocket. I taught them to use them when they need to and not to use them when they don't. You know, I taught them all kinds of things that really makes them see better than anyone who was born with cataracts. So just like I think wheelchair is a good thing because somebody has to sit in a wheelchair, glasses are a good thing for specific situation. But when you put them in your face all day long, it's not a good thing. Look at what happened to your employee, Ivano, yesterday. I told him, here you stand without glasses. Well, I don't see anyone. I said, so what? Okay, so what? Where is the problem? Is he driving? Is he needing to find something in particular? He just gives pages to people. Or holds the microphone for me. Does he need to see everybody well when he holds the microphone for me? I don't think so. So the thing is, it's so mental that you have to always have 20/20 vision. As if it's written in the Bible, thou shalt see 20/20, yeah? Or thou shalt see 6/6. It's not the case. You get used to the vision that you have, even if it's poor, and slowly, slowly it gets better.
What is the connection between healthy food and vision, nutrition and vision?
There's a great connection. I think that let's put the smallest thing in the world, okay? If, you know, when you are a child, when you're born as a child, your metabolism rate is 5 times quicker than an adult metabolism rate, okay? And there is a reason for that, you know, you have bigger muscles when you're grown up, right? So basically your muscles are resting, but then you need to move your muscles. You're much weaker when you're a child and all you're doing is growing and getting more food, right? So if you eat food that is very heavy, you're definitely going to see worse because the food is heavy and it's hard to digest. Now you're going to see worse temporarily, but then you do enough of that and that starts to be your vision, you know? So to begin with, heavy food is hard on the body, and that includes the best food in Italy.
Pizza?
Mm-hmm. Which I love so much. So
there is anything that you want to add to say?
Just talk about your experience.
My experience. I had the visionary sense of the retina.
Yes.
And the surgeon came in to make a surgery. And I said no twice. In my mind, I was going for ballistic treatment. And the surgeon said to me, do not bother, it will be worse. And I asked to myself what I could add in my life. So it was better food, more rest, better oxygenation, yoga, meditation, different things, cure with raw food and enema. And the first time it was worse, in fact. And after that, I was searching for something else. My boyfriend at this moment said to me it will be with that exercise that I will save my hand. And I found EU in a book, me and Raymond Francis' book, Never Sick Again. And I opened the book at the only page where it was mentioned. So I had my answer. So I contacted him. I feel at this moment that San Francisco was very far away from Velocity. Now it, I feel it's near, finally. But I met him in New York, and in 1 month suddenly with one private session, a 2 days workshop, his book and his suggestion. I make exercise during this month, and after that the same surgeon didn't recommend the surgery.
But which kind of ill did you have?
It's in French, it's pseudo poulaminaire. In English, maybe you can say the name.
Pseudo lamellar retinal dystrophy, basically it is.
Okay.
Okay. So the retina basically becomes round and tight, and what they're afraid is that the vitreous will detach the macula, which is the central part of the retina. So the suggestion is to remove the vitreous body. Almost within 3 months, you're going to get cataract. So then they remove the cataract. When they remove the cataract, if everything is okay, it's great, because they remove the lens. If not, then you have retinal detachment, and then they have to fix the retinal detachment. And then you may have all kinds of layers in the retina that they have to peel out, and all kinds of things. So that's when the eye goes.
And maybe the last question. I know that the old people
But I actually want to bring that to the old people. See, what happens is people trust doctors too much.
Yes.
And so they go to the doctors and they do one procedure after another after another. The doctor says, do cataract. Okay. I say, do cataract if your vision is worse than 45%, you see less than 30% of normal vision, okay, do cataract surgery. Sometimes you see 80% of normal vision and doctors say, do the cataract surgery. Why? This is crazy. Because they think there is no risk, but there is a risk. All kinds of things can happen, whether we know it or not know it. Anytime a surgeon puts his knife in your eye, something can happen to your eye. And so what I'm saying is, this is a real good case here, that it's so important to reduce. I'm not saying don't do medical treatment. I've pushed some people who came my way to do surgeries because the situation was so gone and the surgery could have helped them so much. And why not do what they need to do with the medical profession? But there's too many surgeries done that don't have to be done. That yes, if the results are good, it would be great, but what if they're not good, you know? So you stay the way you are unless you really need the surgery. And that is not happening in ophthalmology. If they can do something, they do it. And that's my problem.
But if a person wear very long time glasses or lens,
mm-hmm.
is it easy that he has in some way to have surgery?
No, it's the wrong thing. Because then the eye is weaker. Just think, let me ask you a question. If you run all the time, okay, you have strong legs, right? You fell down, you injured your knee, okay, now they do a surgery, but you have real good muscles. You most likely will recover quickly, okay? Now you sit in a wheelchair all your life, and now they want to do something to your knee. Do you think you're going to recover quickly? No. If you wore glasses all your life, you have weaker eyes. Anytime they touch the eye gets worse. Absolutely.
Do you want to add anything more?
I do. I'm so grateful to you and the good work you're doing here. I think that your goals are wonderful. It's one of those times that you can say money is here to achieve something good, not to have more money, you know. So your goal is to make the world a better place, and my goal is exactly the same as yours. And each one of us work our way to do that. And I really think that it's good that you're giving chance to unknown people, you know, to become known and to make a difference in the world. You see, the world is not changing because somebody in a laboratory or somebody that the whole medical profession admires changes it. Sometimes big professors of medicine bring big changes. But the world changes because the people want the world to change. I remember in California, acupuncture was illegal. Okay? So one helper of the governor in that time, in 1975, you know, came to him and says, one day I'm coming to my acupuncturist, and he's there, and one day I'm coming, he's in jail. Another time I'm coming, he's there. Another time I'm coming, he's in jail. For doing what? For doing acupuncture. So the governor then made a deal in the California Parliament, which is the assembly, and changed the law. And it was a time when Nixon opened the gates with China, you know, and everything seemed to be okay. And they passed a law to make acupuncture legal. There was a time when every chiropractor in America will sit in jail. If he was good, he would sit in jail. And then the unions in the 50s said, hey, we want chiropractors. You know, the Teamster unions that were sitting within trucks and they wanted chiropractors to help the neck, they made the changes. Changes are not going to be by the people who decide how health should be. It will be from the people from the low range up. And so the more you spread the message, it's going to spread better than any other way. It's going to be viral. It's going to go everywhere. And the result is going to be that life will change. That's, you're going to find research. I mean, just the other day I heard that most researches cannot be duplicated. I mean, the first thing you hear in science is only science if you can duplicate it, right? Most research projects cannot be duplicated the way they were made, right? And nobody understands anymore why. Well, the truth of the matter is, many of the conclusions are already pre-existing conclusions about any research which is being done. And the pre-existing conclusion from the medical profession is one cannot improve the vision, one cannot prevent vision problems, one cannot do anything about vision problems. The medical conclude in the 60s that people can do nothing about heart problems. And now they know, because people educated them, that exercise and diet make a difference for the heart. Okay? People thought that nothing that you eat affects your digestion. It's your stomach. It's your nervous system. Now we know how you eat and how you feel affects your digestion. And there's more. The digestive system affects the way you think. The reproductive system affects the way you think. And so there is time for revolution in the world. I'm not talking about Italy, I'm not talking about France, I'm not talking about Spain, I'm talking about China and America, the whole damn world. It's time for revolution, to start to think differently than the way we thought. So I'm very grateful to your existence. It could help a little bit to push forwards consciousness.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah.